A very warm welcome to you all to the Babraham Institute for the second in our series called Bioscience LITE, which we're running in conjunction with our opposite numbers at the Wellcome Trust Genome Campus, which is just down the road. And I know at least one of you came to the previous talk, and we've got another couple planned for the autumn with huge numbers of people signed up for both of those as well. Right, you're all very welcome. It's nice to have you all here. And I'll give you a quick run through about the Babraham Institute. We've got a couple of slides also about the Wellcome Genome Campus, and then we'll move on to our first speaker. There's a plan for tonight, which is in complete disarray already. But as you can see, we should have a speaker. We're going to have a wander over to the BSU, is what we call our animal unit, the Biological Services Unit, where they have a screen set up with live camera feeds from inside the unit. You'll understand we can't get you in there because you'd need to be health screened and showered and so on and so forth, but the camera set up is as close as we can get to getting you in. Some Q&A and then a presentation from James and then some questions. We have some resources at the back. I hope we've got enough to go round, and some suggestions of where you can find other resources will be forthcoming, I dare say, from our speakers. This is the campus. We're over in this building here. And you came in down the Spine Road. It's a glorious campus, as you can see, especially on a day like today. The campus itself is now more than just the Institute. There are six, seven, eight buildings which are for private companies to set up, from small to medium enterprises. There are about 65 on the campus now. They can use the Institute's scientific services. We promote interaction between them and our scientists as much as possible. Ultimately, they can use any of the services that are on the Institute, and we try and maintain relationships with them, and there are a lot of collaborations between the industry and between Institute scientists. The Institute itself is a life sciences research institute funded by the BBSRC, that's the Biotechnology and Biological Sciences Research Council, and our focus is on healthy aging. So obviously aging, not just the bit with the grey hair and the wrinkles, but from conception right the way through. And wherever possible, we try and use our research in collaboration with other academics, with industry, and sending the message out to schools, to the community as much as possible about what we do. And currently we're looking at developmental immunological and aging processes in order to give, to provide improvements to. There's a lot of different ways of talking about it. People talk about health span as well as healthy aging, and then obviously the obvious impact on the economy. And we have four main areas of science: signaling, immunology, nuclear dynamics, and epigenetics. And should you wish more information about any of these, there's a lot of information on our website, and there's some information in the bags that are in each of that each of you have. Our signaling program, the scientists are studying signaling pathways either inside cells or between cells that will maintain the cell's abilities to carry out whatever function it is they do. The immunology program is the study of the immune system, how the body recognizes and fights off infections. Epigenetics is about how chemical modifications to DNA can change how it's expressed without changing the actual sequence of it. And I know that's coming into the A-levels curriculum because I was looking at it this morning. And then finally, our nuclear dynamics program, which is looking at how, essentially how the DNA is packaged within the nucleus to allow it to function correctly. We have nine scientific facilities which are run by the Institute but can be used by Institute scientists, by companies on the campus and beyond. And the Institute has probably around 400 staff. And as with any scientific research organisation, there are several groups with senior scientists at the Institute. We call them group leaders. They will have varying sized groups of research associates, postdoctoral researchers, PhD students, a lot of visitors, and then of course the other roles that are common to any large organisation, engineering, technical support and so on and so forth. So we have a big team of people who support the scientists. We use animals at the Babraham Institute. We use mice at the Institute now. The Institute started about 70 years ago as an agricultural research institute, but there's been no farm animals here for about the last 15 or 20 years. The building we're in at the moment was originally built to study large animals. And The Institute is one of, I think, nearly 100 signatories of the Concordat on Openness in Animal Research. And as such, this is one of the events that we run, which is trying to show how much we are open about what we do. We like to explain the fact that we use animals and explain why and how we use animals to as many people as possible. So as well as events like this, we run regular workshops on ethics for secondary and sixth form students. This evening, this series we call Bioscience LITE. We are here, the Wellcome Genome Campus is only 5 miles away. Our collaborators on this, we both have comprehensive outreach programs for a range of audiences, events, science festivals, and this is our most recent collaboration, which I'm sure is going to go from strength to strength. And so with that, my last slide, which I'd forgotten about, one of the other things we offer for teachers is via the STEM Insights program. So there are brochures in your bags, but it's a chance for teachers to come in to the Institute, come into the labs, work with our scientists, with our facility staff, and with companies on the campus bioincubator to learn more about cutting-edge research equipment techniques. If you're interested, please let me know. The closing date for applications is the 31st of July. And now I'll segue into the Wellcome Genome Campus, who are our collaborators for this event, and pass you over to Fran.
So we offer, like we said, like Babraham, we've got an offer for schools and for teachers to support teaching in the classroom, but also to support your teacher training. So we offer visits to the campus whereby you can meet the scientists, have activities on site, you know, go on a tour, see one of the world's largest sequencing facilities. So, you know, that is offered. We can take up to 30 students at a time currently. So it's an offer for you there. We also have online resources, which are through our website, yourgenome.org, and I'll give you a quick slide on that in a minute. But also we offer CPD training, so we run courses for teachers, similar to short ones like this, but we can also, in the past, we've done two-day trainings on molecular techniques as well. So these are all offers available to teachers. And I will just move on to the next slide. So this is the website I alluded to. And this is yourgenome.org. So again, this is produced by our public engaged team, but also all the content is produced in collaboration with our scientists. So it's accurate, it's current, and it's up to date. So there's a range of resources on there, teaching resources, but also just content that can help you support, or even just give your students actually quite good content to support what they're learning on the specifications. I think that's my slides, isn't it? Oh yes, in your bags, under your chairs, there are postcards, and these sort of highlight just some of the few, or some of the topics that are available on your genome. So we have things like sequencing technologies, infectious disease, cancer, human disease, general DNA genes and genomes, but most relevant for today, using the use of animals in research. And we've got a range of resources, debate pages, fact pages that can help you support that. And that's my little bit done.
So if I can introduce to you John Meredith from Understanding Animal Research, who will give you a great deal of information about how easy it is to talk to your students about the ethics of the use of animals in science, and introduce you probably to some of the best ways of doing it.
Well, we'll see.
Something like that. Thank you. Yes, thank you very much. My name is John Meredith. I've already met all of you, which is good. I'm going to talk about animal research in the classroom. I spent all my time talking about animal research, and most of a big section of that in the classroom talking about animal research. And I would be great if I could perhaps come to some of your classrooms. Maybe you can think about that next term. We're always looking for opportunities to come and talk to young people about this subject. And I hope I can persuade you that it is an extremely rich and rewarding and actually not too intimidating a subject to address with young people. And really, I think, I mean, we usually are talking about secondary school, that's where we usually pitch it, but I almost wouldn't say there's a limit on where you can take this. Now, there's a lot of concerns about it, there's been a lot of anxiety about talking about the subject everywhere, not just in schools, obviously, but within the industry as well. We sometimes call our talk the A word, because the word animal was so, you know, was resisted for so long, and one wanted to mention the animals.
John, sorry.
Sorry, Mike.
I think when I passed your microphone, I managed to turn it off.
Oh, have we switched off?
I believe.
Nah.
Is that better? Are we getting you now? So they may have missed the preamble, but don't worry, I'm not going to preamble it all over again. So we've been I talk about this subject a lot, and we've been talking about it for a long time. Our organization, we're called Understanding Animal Research. We used to be the Research Defense Society. We've been around for 100 years, engaging in the public discussion of why animals get used in science. We begin with the Little Brown Dog Affair, or the Brown Dog Affair. I don't know if any of you have heard of this. This was in 1903. It lasted for about 7 to 10 years. And it was the first public infiltration by animal rights protesters at University College in London. And they, Swedish, actually, enrolled students as students, and they published what they claimed was an example of horrendous vivisection using a little brown dog in London. And they claimed that this dog was used for grotesque experimentation, live in front of students and without proper medication or without proper pain management or anything like that. There was a huge case about it, huge furore. I think it led to a very famous libel case, which was won, but at great cost, by the university. It led to a public inquiry into the use of animals in medical research. It led, actually, tangentially to our organization and organizations like ours getting formed to try and make a counter balance to the arguments against the use of animals. And actually, there were riots in London over this little brown dog, with medical students forming on one side of the argument and animal rights protesters forming another. This statue was erected in Battersea Park. The enemies, the factions, one other faction would sort of clash over this statue and would try and pull it down. It eventually had to have a police cordon placed around it. It was an amazing story. Eventually, Battersea Park decided that enough was enough and they got rid of it, but it was re-erected. A new statue was re-erected in the 80s. So this has been going on for some time. We all know that it's controversial and difficult. This is this is what it said on the podium at the bottom there. Memory of the brown terrier dog, my highlighting course. Men and women of England, how long shall these things be? It's a bit fruity. It's a little bit, perhaps a little bit overheated, as we sometimes have got used to with some of the movements against some of the protesters against animal research. But the question is still a live one. The question is still a live one. How long will this be? We don't know. But it's a question, actually, that's worth asking. And it's a question that young people are often asking themselves, or very quick to understand the implications of asking. So far from needing to be scared of this subject in the classroom, I would say the very heat it generates is a benefit to you when you want to get your students really thinking about the ethical implications of science, because they're already there. And although it's a difficult question in some technical aspects, it's usually something that even quite young students can quickly grasp the questions that they're being asked to consider, even though they may have to be introduced to some of the nuances along the way a little bit. The new science curriculum, which is the current science curriculum, is very strong on asking us to consider the ethical issues which may arise from appreciating the power and limitations of science. This is a wonderful subject for the ethical implications of applied science. It's very, very vivid, and it's got a very direct emotional impact. Subject content in biology, they've got to think about the process of discovery and development of new medicines, which, of course, animal research is a fundamental part of, and where many of the curricula in the past shrunk from really giving it its proper place. I was talking to a teacher earlier on, it seems that this is being addressed somewhat now. We're seeing the animals given their proper place, but perhaps teachers don't always feel that they're entirely competent or confident in addressing a subject, anticipating it being rather fraught. And as well, some of the practical and ethical considerations of modern biotechnology. Well, animal research is right there. It will tend to go to some philosophical center of the question. I know a lot of science teachers don't like the philosophy too much. They prefer the world of fact. That's not true of all of them by any means, but they prefer the world of clear facts and shrink from these big ethical questions. And this is one of the questions, in one form or another, which I nearly always get asked when I go to a class and talk. Eventually someone will say, why not people? It's the fundamental question. Why is it okay to do this to one group of feeling, thinking animals, but not another group? And they will go to this sort of fundamental question. It's only difficult to answer this if we feel we have to have an answer or a categorical answer. Once you help people see, when you teach us especially to see and understand that the question is more to draw in a measured, thoughtful dealing with the different ways of thinking about the question rather than present them with a correct outcome. And this goes for us in the world of animal research too. We should be about guiding the public conversation towards a measured, thoughtful, informed discussion of the issues rather than saying there is one correct prescribed outcome. And in fact, helping people understand how many of these sort of questions are getting asked inside the laboratory as well. But of course, we do have answers. Maybe it's a question of sentience. Maybe the sentience of the human being puts it into a separate category from animals. And that's probably the way most people who work with animals in medical research consider that question. But we shouldn't make it too easy on ourselves. I like to put this to them sometimes: which of these animals is most sentient? This is a question that the philosopher Peter Singer often asks. The one-year-old baby or the beagle pup? It's not an easy question to answer. Which one of those animals is more sentient? Of course, one of them may be, have sentience coming its way that the other one will be incapable of. But not all children are going to develop the mental faculties that of a normal adulthood. So the questions needn't be easy to answer. They needn't have a definite answer or outcome. Our job, I feel, is more about giving them a field in which they can be expressed and the nuances and complexities can be expressed, which is satisfying to these young people, allowing them to address a subject like this and still come away with uncertainty, but being aware that there is an argument, a complex argument to be had. There's no easy takeout from it. There's no easy position of banning. But of course, we do tend to think of animals as being sentient, and if I ask a class, as I often do, after I'm going to tomorrow in London, if I asked them to put these animals in order of sentience, I bet we would have quite a lot of consensus. I'm not going to make you do it. I was thinking about it. I bet we'd all agree that the fruit fly is the least sentient animal in that group. The fruit fly, I always have to remind myself, whenever I'm in a class, I always have to remind them that this is not an actual to-scale picture of a fruit fly. These animals, that does not exist in a lab. A monstrous fly, that obviously we all know that this is the little Drosophila. And we could probably agree that fish comes next. Mouse there, let's say rat. And after that, the dog, marmoset monkey, and the ape. It's an opportunity when I do this to demonstrate that although we can argue about the moral validity of placing animals in some sort of hierarchy, whether it's based on sentience or whatever it should be based on, we usually do instinctively see some sort of, think of animals as in some sort of hierarchy. And of course, we do not use great apes in medical research in the United Kingdom or in Europe. You may not know that. It's the cutoff point of which animals can be used is at the great apes. We can use anything below that that you can justify in your application to the Home Office based on the science that you're trying to do. The only great ape that we do use, of course, being Homo sapiens, being us. That's a fun question. It's fun for me to put it to kids. They usually just groan. And the only invertebrate here that's protected by law in the United Kingdom, the octopus or the other cephalopods, is perhaps the one that is hardest to put in that hierarchy. So there are still unanswered questions. Letting the world know, letting your students know, letting the general public know that we don't have all the answers, that we are still proceeding in uncertainty, I think is a very enriching and valuable and exciting for them. It's a good opportunity, if you want to go more generally, to talk about philosophy and give people a grounding in some philosophical ideas themselves. You don't have to be a philosopher to enter into this. I often talked about the idea of utilitarianism, useful long word, that this is the moral framework with which we think about animals, basically weighing up the costs against the benefits, and that this is quite a normal thing we'll do in lots of other aspects of our lives and using animals. And this is the famous trolley problem. Do you pull the lever to save five and rescue one? I'm not going to go into it, but there's various other levels that can go down. Young people love this sort of thought experiment. They absolutely love it. They love arguing with you. They love pushing back against the terms you give them. The next slide, if I was doing this, usually would involve not just pulling a lever, but pushing somebody in front of the tram to stop it and analyzing, trying to understand something, why we might enjoy, why it might seem acceptable to pull the lever, but not to push the person. And you don't have to go too deep. I think there's great value in introducing them to a basic framework, philosophical framework, but also making it more difficult for ourselves than we have to. You know, putting in front of them that there are limits to what we can, to our own understanding and the way we can think about this. But animal research is an example of, I mean, that was a more academic sort of philosophy. Animal research is a very good example of science applying practical ethics in the everyday. And it's embedded in the law, and it's embedded in practice, and you'll see it when you see the unit later on. I think you'll see this this sort of philosophical principle embedded in actual practice all the time. The principle of the three R's, which some of you may be familiar with. If you go anywhere near an animal unit, anywhere in the country, you will hear it immediately and over again. The three R's are these: replace, reduce, and refine. They must, by law, be applied all the time when we're using animals. Replace is easy. If you can do it another way, you must. It is illegal to use an animal for research if there is a practical alternative. Reduce, well, just use fewer animals. But refine is fun. Refine is, the woman says, well, if you can't replace it, you've done what you can to reduce it. What can you do to refine your procedure so that the animal suffers the least possible stress or pain or distress? So an obvious refinement would be using pain management, if in an operation or something, if that was practical, to reduce the pain the animal feels, and usually is practical, and that's what usually happens. Refining is, I like to ask young people to think about this concept through applying it themselves. Here's a good little clip. It's very, very short. Tons of this stuff on our website and elsewhere. There's so many resources out there now to use when you're talking about this subject. And you probably know from your own experience that young people love to see pictures of animals. Here's a macaque monkey. It's not a typical research animal, but it is used. It's going to be used for, I think, a toxicological study. So they're going to want to take blood out of the vein on its leg. So watching this clip, we can ask, where's the refinement? Where's the refinement? And that's it. That's all they need to see. I always find that they get there in the end, sometimes straight away, and they're actively watching and seeing it. Now, perhaps I don't, are we finished, am I finished at six, Michael, or a little?
Six, had we started at the right time, yes.
Yes, but.
You've perhaps got 5-10 minutes more.
Okay, I felt that that time had sped past even faster than anticipated, but it, so what's the refinement? Can I put it to you? Who, someone want to have a guess?
They let him move the leg out by himself.
Yes, straight on. You'd be amazed how quickly young people get that. If they don't, of course, you can give them some clues. What haven't you seen that you might expect to see when you're about to stick a needle into a monkey that's 5 times as strong as an adult human? So it's putting the leg out. It's trained to do the work. We have many other clips of dogs being dosed, such things. And they're very useful ways of like directly thinking about applying a moral framework in practical terms in the lab. So that monkey, no one is there to say that this monkey's life is ideal. It lives in a lab. It doesn't live in the conditions. You've seen it there, of course. I can show them other clips when we have a very good new tour of a monkey unit in Oxford, where you can see the living conditions that these monkeys are actually in. It's not an ideal life for a macaque monkey. We're not claiming it is. What we're claiming is that given that they are going to be used for the reasons we give, which is, in our view, there is no alternative. In our view, some progress in science can only be achieved by using animals, and the law agrees with that. Given those conditions, we can do a lot to reduce the pain and stress and distress that those animals experience. And that's a really good example of it. There's an AWERB in every facility you visit. An AWERB is an Animal Welfare Ethical Review Body, which reviews any application to the Home Office before it goes forward. It will often include lay people, sometimes even people from animal protest groups or organizations like the RSPCA, as well as veterinary staff and scientists and license holders. The AWERB is, of course, a great opportunity to get your young people thinking directly and in practical terms about animal research in specific in a specific context. And here's one, and this means that there's loads out there. If you go onto the Home Office website, you can find the non-specialist summaries of all the animal research that's going on in the United Kingdom. It's a great resource if you can spade it out. Here's one that I use sometimes in classrooms. You can change the language depending on the level that you're trying to get and the time you've got. I'm going to be doing this with a group of year sevens tomorrow in London, with three year sevens, with the wording slightly changed. But it's actually approved, but we'll be asking them whether or not they're going to prove it in a group, and then sharing as a class what we decide. This is for a study in Huntington's disease, but it's using sheep and it's a non-proven model, so there's all sorts of things to discuss. Ask them to think about some fundamental questions as they look at it, discussing it in their groups, try and come to a consensus in their individual groups, and then feedback. And it's a really, really easy to manage and activity, but it's also one that drives them to think about ethical and practical ethical application, which they could be directly involved with, possibly themselves, at some time in the future, and which is a real example from the real world. So we'd ask them questions that the AWERB should be asking. You know, is this research important enough? Is it significant enough to justify the animals? Are they convinced by the claims made that they've just read in terms of the severity, etc.? Have the 3 R's been applied appropriately? This is something that you would have to explain when you're making your application for any such license. Do they have any questions they want resolved? And are they going to approve it, reject it, or are they going to ask, or would they need more information, which is often the position that we find them taking, wanting to sort of sit on the fence. It encourages a really deep, a really thoughtful engagement with a very complex, suddenly very complex moral issue, and an understanding of just how complex and difficult this is. We're always saying to our teachers, we're not here to convert your children into supporters of animal research. We're here to change their uninformed dissent into informed dissent, where that's appropriate, or otherwise simply to let them understand what a complex and nuanced and finely balanced sometimes decision this sort of thing is. There's nothing we should feel that we can't, in principle, show them. We show a lot of animals, and we show lots of more attractive sides, show lots of the typical stuff of mice and cages. I am always wary about showing too many of the big glamorous animals and giving the impression that more of these are used, because of course overwhelmingly the species we use are mice, fish, rats and birds. That's what, 98%, James, something like that, 99% of those species. But the biggest species are where people often have most concern, and here's a macaque monkey, you know, very high level species. It's being used for some very severe research, so it couldn't recover from this in time because it's had the top of its skull removed. It'll be used for live neurological studies, and you can see pictures of this monkey, or one model very like it, on our website, actually in a study, so you can see what's happening. So there's nothing we can't put forward to them. You know, we can really present the reality as far as we understand it and know it. Although I like to balance that up with something like this little clip I'll show you now of Mike Robbins. Mike Robbins has had deep brain stimulation surgery developed on a similar model, not the same one, but a similar model to that macaque monkey we just saw. So using a live monkey model for doing experimental brain surgery. Now he's had this treatment for Parkinson's disease. I'm going to let him tell you about it because it's worth seeing this clip. If you haven't seen it, you can download it, I think, from our website. But I should tell you, as I would tell them, to bear in mind watching it, that although this terrific therapeutic advance came through this surgery, they could not be sure of that before they began the animal study. So it was always a difficult balance. They could not know that it was going to succeed. They may have done their research and found that they ran into the buffers. So here's Mike. You can see why I find this such a powerful, I think you'll see why I find this such a powerful thing to show to young people.
The probe that is placed into the brain, I understand, comes level with the top of the nose and the ear. And it is connected to a battery in my chest, in the skin of my chest here. And this is controlled. I can control the amount of the voltage going in, I can control the length of time of the pulses, and I can identify the number of times per second that it goes in. And I'll turn myself off now. Tremor and trying to control it. And I'm thinking the word Parkinson's all the time. I'm not terribly, I'm not concentrating on my conversation with you at all.
Quite wearing, he says, and I think you can see why I find this such a powerful clip to show. I played this once in a school. We'd had a group in an East London school, and they had been a little sceptical, you could say, during the talk. And then after we played the clip, there was suddenly a pin drop silence, and then this lone voice from the back said, "Man, that's it. Them rats can die." And I think, well, that's not exactly the message we're out there to put out there, but there's the understanding that it's a balance, that there's a purpose to this, that the concern for those rats is legitimate and important, but it must be placed in the balance of the potential for human benefits had been got over. Thanks very much for listening. We have tons of resources and things, and as I say, we would love to come to your school to talk about this with the kids or lead debates or whatever it is that you might be interested in. Thanks very much, Michael.
I think probably a small round of applause.
Thank you very much, John. That concludes our first presentation. We can take a quick break now to wander across and have a look at our animal unit. So if you would like to gather your stuff together, we'll move across there. Thank you very much.